Here on 2, we begin a new series of workshop as Paul Crossley delves beneath the surface of one of the finest masters of orchestral music, Mirrors, Reflections on Maurice Ravel.
At the end of the first performance of this piece in 1928, a woman was seen clutching the back of her seat, absolutely shocked, crying, "He's mad, he's mad." When this was reported to Ravel, he simply smiled and said, "She has understood." In one of his typically extreme, ironic remarks, Ravel later described it as a piece for orchestra without music. And that points to what is shocking. He'd been asked to orchestrate some piano pieces by Albéniz as a theatre piece for the dancer Ida Rubinstein. But when he found out that somebody else had the rights to this, he set out, almost in a fit of pique, to produce his own controlled exercise in orchestration. But, as we know, controlled reactors produce dangerous byproducts. With its beguiling melody, its obsessive rhythm, its harmonic void, Bolero is elemental, inflammatory, maddened with desire, the embodiment of unreason, without music, without harmony. Absurd. It's a powerful cocktail of the mechanical, the sexual, the fatal. An infernal machine, an absurd mechanism, a tourbillon de mort. The tourbillon de mort was one of the inventions of Ravel's father, who was an engineer and a considerably gifted inventor. It was a sort of wheel of death with a car that turned somersaults. And in the early years of this century, it did the rounds of the world's variety theatres. It even appeared at Barnum and Bailey Circus in the USA. But more than just a tour de force, it was a dangerous device, and it ended up killing its driver. Like many of the pieces that Ravel wrote after the First World War, it carried the seeds of its own destruction. Paradoxically, that disquieting music is written by a man who was fastidious, secretive, dandyish, childlike, whose music seems so often the epitome of sanity and lucidity. But the world of Ravel is a world with two suns, a radiant golden sun and a dark companion. That duality was noticed very early on. His lifelong friend, the Spanish pianist Ricardo Viñez, pronounced Ravel at 21 a mixture of Middle Ages Catholicism and satanic impiety. The works themselves separate out into two different categories, which might be characterized as light, dark, innocence, experience, paradise, inferno, classical poise, romantic agony, the beautiful and the damned. All appropriate, but all limited and limiting. What is really fascinating is Ravel's absolute need to hold both sides in equilibrium so that he almost invariably had two works on the go at the same time. If we just look at the piano works, the most well-known example of this parallel composition is that of the two piano concertos, and we're going to examine those closely later on. But this seems to have been a persistent practice. Also composed in tandem were the Sonatine and Miroir.
Thank you. to the Mozartian innocence of that opening of the sonatine is opposed the turbulent Une barque sur l'océan, a boat on the ocean, from Miroir, a romantic bateau ivre that symbolizes the dangerous undercurrents of passion. Another example is Mother Goose and Gaspard de la Nuit. That is Le Jardin Féerique, the magic garden that in Ravel must be constantly recreated. But alongside that image of bliss and its ultra-simplicity lurks the fiendishly virtuoso, dark, satanic world of Gaspard de la Nuit, a nickname for the devil himself. Here's the evil hobgoblin, Scarabeau. And what about Le Tombeau de Couperin, the garden laid out this time in the French 18th century style? Well, fascinatingly, it appears that it had an invisible companion, projected but never finally realized. Ravel said it was to have been called Nuit Romantique, and he described it in a letter as full of spleen, with a hunt in hell, an accursed nun, etc. So, always these two extremes. And what holds them together is that they're all idealized worlds, romance worlds, whether magic gardens or gothic horrors, theaters of the imagination, worlds of dreams, like the one we're in, the cinema, invented just as Ravel begins to compose, and for which he composed his last completed work, the Don Quixote songs. But perhaps his most cinematic work, and it was reputedly his favorite, is the song cycle, Scheherazade.
First song, Asie, Asia, is a paradigm for much of Ravel's work, a fabulous voyage of the imagination that takes us to an unknown continent without ever leaving a room. Each section of the song opens with the words je voudrais, I would like, a catalogue of desires. And in many ways, that is the form of all Ravel's works, a catalogue of desires, everything held together by a series of implied I would likes. Ravel's great task was to turn that conditional I would like into music that offers unconditionally. So there was always the constant requirement to find the perfect musical object to embody these perfect desires. Ravel struggled long and hard, looking everywhere for these musical emblems of desire. He made no bones about the fact that his aim was technical perfection, that in his works no detail had been left to chance, that everything unnecessary had been eliminated to achieve a definitive clarity. Well, all this art, this artfulness, has always disturbed many people, who find this attitude cold and unspontaneous. But That's why Ravel was so fascinated by the figure of Scheherazade, who had to tell stories to preserve her life. If her fantasy didn't succeed, she died. A veritable life story. Her sheer calculation, as we know, produced 1,001 stories, but what stimulated all this invention was that she was in love with the king, her audience. It was calculation, all right, but never cold calculation. The last song of the Scheherazade cycle, L'Indifférent, is a portrait of Ravel's relationship with the world. The focus of desire in this song is a young man, almost an androgynous figure, who stands forever just out of reach, just on the threshold, indifferent to all advances, unattainable, idealized by distance. But nobody hearing the ecstatic falling phrase in the high strings will fail to notice that the music reaches out with infinite longing. Is a kind of storytelling, tales of mystery and imagination, to quote one of his acknowledged spiritual godfathers, Edgar Allan Poe. And storytelling involves dressing up. He dresses in borrowed robes. Here he is in Borodin's.
or in Chabrier's. Even in a mandarin's costume. It drove his detractors mad. His arch enemy, the music critic Pierre Lalot, wrote, "Ravel is all insensitivity, borrowing without hesitation, not only the technique of others, but also the sensitivity of others." God knows what he would have said if he'd known, as has only recently been revealed, that Ravel wrote this. Fascination, published in 1904 under the name of F.D. Marchetti, actually by Maurice Ravel. Well, if that's all there is to it, we'd be talking about something rather arch, a bit precious, a bit camp even, and Ravel would only be a minor master, as many detractors claim. But it brings us to another of Ravel's dualities. He got fed up with people who called him insensitive and artificial. He said one day to a friend, "Has it never occurred to these people that I might be artificial by nature?" From the start of his artistic career, Ravel nailed his colours to the mast. He referred to himself in an early letter as the little symbolist. We're in the artistic realm of Baudelaire, Verlaine, Rimbaud, and Mallarmé. They were also Ravel's spiritual godfathers. He never ceased to acknowledge their influence. The symbolist artist was one who stood apart, exiled himself from the world to live only in his dreams, savoring his sensations, and then minting particular symbols to suggest them. Mallarmé prescribed how this was to be accomplished. By detaching himself, the artist would turn himself into something else, a vessel in which his ideal worlds would crystallize. Mallarmé's extraordinary poetic image for this was that of an empty room containing nothing but a fantastically decorated gilt-framed mirror on which the ideal world would be reflected. Rimbaud put it very succinctly, "Je est un autre," I is another. Ravel had a name, or rather better, a symbol for this other. That's Ravel's own design for the cover of Le Tombeau de Couperin, and unveiled there is an invention much more elaborate and complex than anything dreamt of by Maurice Ravel's father. And it has two names, Le Tombeau de Couperin and M.R., Ravel's, and the calligraphy suggests it, ideogram. We don't know who Maurice Ravel was. He took great pains to make sure that we don't, but we do know who M.R. is. He's Mallarmé's fantastically decorated mirror, and depending on the decoration, he's sometimes called Le Tombeau de Couperin, sometimes Daphnis and Chloe, sometimes Gaspard la Nuit, sometimes just mirrors. Miroir. M.R. is a succession of ideal selves, and he's a construct of style. As a child, Ravel had been taken to the World Fair in Paris, the so-called Universal Exhibition, and he'd been exposed to all manner of unknown and exotic cultures, Japanese, Chinese, North African,
even early American ragtime.
And as an artist, Ravel treated the whole world of music as though it were a universal exposition. But it was the universal he was after, the essence of something. During his final illness, he was taken on a trip to North Africa, and he was feted by the ruler in Marrakesh, treated to a banquet and a fantastic display of music and dancing. When it was suggested that this might inspire him to write something, he said, "If I were to write something Arab, it would be much more Arab than all this." And that much more than quality is the universal quality of Ravel's music. And the gift that enabled him to achieve it was the gift of the child's heart. He's the child in all of us. He's the one who can play the game of let's pretend to its ultimate extremes. Of all Ravel's party clothes, his favorite is probably the Spanish costume. He's more entitled to it than most, an inheritance from his Basque mother, and its idealization came very naturally to him. Of all the names for MR, Alborada del Gracioso is one of the most curious, but also one of the most revealing. Alborada, an obad, a song sung at dawn to rouse lovers from their night of bliss, to break the dream and to warn them of approaching day. The Gracioso's obad. But what, who is the Gracioso? The word is usually translated into English as jester or buffoon, but those words aren't quite specific enough. The Gracioso was a stock figure of Spanish drama, a creature of extreme native cunning who contrives things so that the hero will win through, sort of fixer. The most classic example of the Gracioso known to us is Figaro. He's the one who calls the tune and then watches ironically and comically from a distance. Ravel is the Gracioso. There's a lovely story about Ravel. in Cibourg, in the Basque country, which was his birthplace, they decided to name a street in his honor, the Quai Maurice Ravel. Naturally, he was invited to the ceremony, and he agreed to be present. However, at the appointed time, no Ravel. So they had to go ahead without him. But he was there, sitting on the other side of the square in a pavement cafe, sipping his wine, watching it all happening. Ravel watching the Ravel ceremony. Ravel was always on ceremony. Here is part of Valse Noble Sentimentale, called by Ravel in its orchestral version, Le Langage des Fleurs, the language of flowers, which, according to Mallarmé, was the language that symbolist artists should strive to speak. Perhaps this balanced, detached, essentially comic view of the world could have gone on unchanged. But La Belle Époque came to an end for Ravel, as it did for France, as it did for the world. The war reduced him creatively to silence. The Pleasure Dome collapsed. The horrors were no longer gothic. Although he was by then 40, he managed to get himself enlisted as a truck driver, but his health, which had always been delicate, broke down, and he was sent home just in time to face the great watershed of his life, the death of his beloved Maman. Maman had been the center of his world. The room from which he journeyed in his imagination had been at home with Maman. He never married. He was shattered. As late as 1919, he was writing to a friend, "I think of those former times at the charming apartment on Avenue Carnot, where I was so happy. I realize that it will soon be 3 years since she died, and my despair increases from day to day. Since I've begun working again, I'm thinking about it more. I no longer have that dear, silent presence enveloping me with her infinite tenderness, which was, I see more than ever, my only reason for living." A new Maurice Ravel is born into the world, and he's homeless. Eventually, the creative genius returned, but all his post-First World War work is preoccupied with this idea of homelessness. If there are any ideal worlds, they're much more precarious and elusive and have to be redeemed. But first, the shattering of his world, the world, symbolized by that extraordinary work, La Valse, the waltz, that epitome of civilization, now turns into a dance of death. The piece is built up out of nothing. It reveals a world that's attractive, intoxicating, increasingly disquieting, and finally, systematically and ruthlessly destroyed. The coup de grace to this waltz is administered by a devastating...
In time, he found a room of his own again. Le Belvedere, a little house in Montfort-l'Amaury, to the west of Paris, which he decorated in all manner of bizarre styles, a new deluxe cabin for his symbolist soul to inhabit. And here he composed one of his most deeply felt works, the opera L'Enfant et les Sortilèges. The libretto was by Colette, and he set it, as he said, in the style of an American musical comedy, that is, as a series of song and dance routines. It's a simple story of a naughty little boy who defies his mother and in a temper tantrum destroys the world around him, breaks the furniture, tears the wallpaper in his books, tortures the animals. But they come to life, and when he reaches out for them, they reject him. Even out in his magic garden, the creatures are indifferent to him. He feels lonely and out of place, and cries out for his mother. The creatures turn on him, and in the confusion that ensues, a squirrel is injured, and the child binds up its wound. The creatures forgive him, and singing of how good he is, they lead him back home to Maman. It's one of the great parables of redemption. Hearing the final falling forth on the word Maman, we understand what all those falling forths are about in Ravel. This is paradise. The wound inside Maurice Ravel was not so easily healed. Conflicts remained, raw and exposed. We all feel that there's a special aura about late works, that they probe the mysteries of existence in a final attempt to get at some meaning. In his last works, the two piano concertos, Ravel was at last able to give supreme creative expression to his conflicting nature. For years, this great composer for the piano had contemplated a work for piano and orchestra. It just wouldn't come. And then, out of the blue, the Austrian pianist Paul Wittgenstein, a brother of the philosopher Ludwig Wittgenstein, who'd lost his right arm in the First World War, offered Ravel a commission to write a concerto for the left hand alone. And he was off, working on both concertos simultaneously. The concerto is one of music's great ancestral homes. And in the two piano concertos, Ravel offers us descriptions of the world and our place in it. Of all the composers commissioned by Wittgenstein, Ravel was the only one who used the left hand as a symbol of man's condition in the world. Is existence good and meaningful, or meaningless, absurd? Two hands, or just a left hand? The concerto is the most dramatic of all musical forms, not only in its content, but also in performance as a theatre of gestures. Ravel turns it here into a theatre of the absurd. The original hero, Wittgenstein, was a victim of the war, a scapegoat. I have two hands, but Ravel absolutely and adamantly refused to countenance a two-handed version. The left-handedness, the absurdity, must be upheld. Not only that, but the odds against the left hand are overwhelming. An enormous symphony orchestra. Not only almost always tutti, but almost always loud. Soloists are given no room at all. The orchestra is just a sort of anonymous they. It's a sort of totalitarian orchestration. The relationship between the piano and orchestra is peculiarly uncertain. In fact, in a piece which lasts for 18 minutes, they only actually play together for about 9. The soloist is very much an outsider. Musically, Ravel sets up expectations which are constantly thwarted. First expectation. This is sometimes called Concerto in D major, but that was not Ravel's title. And after an opening crash, the soloist enters in A minor for all the world as if he were going to play one of the great A minor concertos, the Grieg or the Schumann, like this. But he only has one hand, so all he can play is this. A rather stiff attempt at majesty, and it's followed by a stately theme that's like the tune of the peacock in Ravel's Histoire naturelle, the peacock who demands admiration but whom no one notices. But you notice the orchestra, all bombast, the arrogance and power of two hands. Just where you expect a slow movement, you get it, the piano singing a bittersweet song, but the orchestra simply won't join in. Just where you expect a Saint-Saëns scherzo. You get it, but instead of that innocent merriment, it's a savage compound of goose-stepping march, sardonic blues, and quaint excursions into Chinatown. Another infernal whirl. Eventually the piano is thrown out of the whirl, and in a magnificent cadenza, the left hand is at last able to come to terms with the world of this concerto. Futile aspiration. The orchestra simply dispatches the soloist with an arbitrary and merciless thumbs down.
It's not surprising that people have felt that in the tragic dignity of this work, Ravel at last lowers his guard. This time, Ravel looks into his mirror and sees as M.R. himself, a man, unclothed, like Wittgenstein, like us all, a ruined piece of nature. He's mad. He's mad. Ravel knew that the woman had understood he, with a capital H. Well, the last years of Maurice Ravel's life were cruel. He wasted away with some undiagnosed complaint, possibly, in the opinion of a doctor friend of mine, Alzheimer's disease, which progressively enfeebled his mental and physical powers. One day, a friend called to see him and found him sitting on his balcony, staring out into space. She said, "What are you doing?" And without turning, Ravel said, "I'm waiting."